Hey everyone, in today's video, I am going to share 5 tips to help your struggling readers. Now, if you are a teacher with a group of struggling readers in your classroom, then this video will definitely apply to you. But also, if you are a parent with a struggling reader at home, here are some tips that can also help you help your student best at home. If you're ready to hear these 5 tips, give this video a like, subscribe to my channel, and let's get started. All right, tip number 1 is to find out exactly where your student is struggling. Now, if you are reading a story with your student at home or a student in the classroom, and they are just struggling quite a bit, whether it's with the comprehension of the story or if they are having trouble decoding all the words on the page, it might be difficult for you to understand exactly what part is kind of tripping them up. And so this is a great time to do a screener. Now, you can find plenty of phonic screeners online, but you'll want one that has clear instructions and that makes sense. So 2 of my favorites are the Quick Phonics Screener that you can find for free online, as well as the Core Phonics Screener. Now, if you are a parent and you've never given this screener before, or if you are a teacher and you're going to use a new screener, always be sure to read the instructions carefully before you give this assessment to your students. The directions should be clear and tell you which sheet to give the kids, what prompts to give, and also when to stop, right? Because with the diagnostic screener, you don't want to just keep going past their struggle points. You want to find out the sweet spot. You want to find out what they know, and then you want to find out where they are getting tripped up when they're having trouble. Now, once you have given students your screener, it will help you identify what part of phonics they are getting stuck on. Are they still getting stuck on short vowel sounds? Are they having trouble decoding CVC words? Are they having trouble when that silent E is applied to a word, or when there are blends in a word, consonant blends? It will be broken down into those categories so you can see where your student needs help, and you want to back up and reteach those skills. Now, once you've identified where your students are struggling, you want to find on a scope and sequence what lessons you want to start with, right? Because you want to go back to where your students are struggling. Even if you are at home and you're teaching your students other lessons, you want to go back. We want to make sure they have mastery of these skills before we continue to progress, because as those words become more difficult and include more of those phonics patterns, your students will have trouble decoding them. So you want to take the information you find out on the screener and place your students somewhere on a scope and sequence. Now, there are many different literacy and phonics scope and sequences out there. I have mentioned a few in the past. Some of the ones I love are this letters one right here. I particularly love this one because it shows when students should be able to decode different phonics patterns as well as encode them. But I've also heard in the past that this screener can look a little intimidating and hard to follow. So I also love this one right here from UFLI, the University of Florida Literacy Institute. This one is very user-friendly and you can quickly identify the lessons that you'll want to start with when teaching your students. Just to show you what this might look like, here is an example of the quick phonics screener that I would give to my student. Now, if I already knew that my student knew all their letter names and letter sounds, I would completely skip task A and task B, which is letter names and letter sounds, and I would move right on to decoding. If I don't know that about my student yet, we would start there. So if students were able to read all these CVC words in isolation and in sentences, again, we would move on to the consonant blends. Let's pretend my student knew 9 out of 10 of these words. We could move on to task 4. And if my student is struggling here with these words with silent E, either in isolation or in sentences, this is where I want my instruction to begin. So taking that information, I can then look at this scope and sequence right here. And this would tell me I can start my lessons here by teaching that long A with silent E on the end. And we can work through these VCE concepts. Now, many scopes and sequences are going to be different and they have a few different skills, but as you can see here, first this scope and sequence goes through all the letters of the alphabet, and then it goes on to some review words with consonant blends in there, but it also has some things like lessons 42 through 53. While it does include digraphs, it also includes some other skills like the floss rule and the A-L-L-O-L-L-U-L-L patterns. So if you think your student doesn't know those yet, you could also give those lessons as well. So tip 1 is basically to make sure you give your students a screener and find out exactly where their instruction needs to begin by looking at a research-based scope and sequence. And don't worry, all the screeners I mentioned, as well as those scope and sequences, I will have listed down in the description below. Tip 2 to help your struggling readers is more of a mindset tip, and it is for you to remember that it's going to take longer for your students to learn how to read. Now that might sound discouraging, but it's actually not. It's just a simple fact. Some students might be able to hear a lesson, learn new information, and master it only after 3 to 5 repetitions. But that is a very small percentage of students, and those students are typically labeled as gifted. Your students that are struggling to read not only need more repetitions of a lesson, but they also need a longer duration or intensity of literacy instruction. So instead of 10 minutes of instruction, some of your readers might need 20 to 30 minutes, and they might need to spend much longer on one particular skill than some other students. Again, I don't want that to sound discouraging. If anything, it should just be a mindset shift for you as the parent or the teacher to know that you are doing the right thing and you want to keep repeating it and giving your student those exposures so that they can effectively learn a new skill. Now, I will say the caveat to that is to make sure while you are repeating all this information to them and repeating these lessons that they are research-based lessons, and we're gonna talk about that a little bit later. You, of course, don't want to be repeating something that isn't working, but just know that with your students, it is going to take more time, and that is A-okay. So if you're working with a student at home, make sure you are spending enough time on a concept for your student to master it, however long that might take them, and also make sure you're spending enough time per lesson with your students. And if you are a teacher in the classroom, you want to make sure your struggling readers are receiving those tiered interventions. Make sure they are staying with you for that tier one instruction where you're teaching the whole class. But then make sure, are they getting an additional, 10 to 15 minutes working on that same concept? And if they need it more, if they're in tier three, are they getting another additional allotment of time for them to continue working on those skills to catch them up? All the answers to those questions are going to vary depending on your own student, what their needs are, as well as your classroom block and period of time in which your students get these resources, but those are just questions you want to ask yourself and a mindset shift you want to make. This leads us right into tip number 3, which is to make sure you're following research-based interventions. Now, your research-based intervention should, of course, have a scope and sequence. I shared that UFLI one earlier. So it should have a progression of skills that your students are working on. So once they've mastered one, you move to the next, and you can see when to go back as you need. A good research-based intervention should also have all of the following. So ask yourself, does it include phonemic awareness practice? Does it include explicit phonics lessons? Does it include time for decoding texts as well as encoding texts? Does it include some sort of vocabulary component and comprehension component? And does it include handwriting? When you're thinking about the interventions, lessons, and activities that you are giving your struggling readers, you want to make sure it includes all of those components. There are many different programs out there, but if you're looking for a few recommendations, here's where you can start. First is the UFLI Foundations book. I have mentioned this a few times. It was the scope and sequence that I shared with you. But again, this is the University of Florida Literacy Institute. You can buy this book. It is pretty inexpensive. And the entire scope and sequence for kindergarten to first grade, a full list of lessons is in here. And they also have a digital component where you can go online and get different teaching slides, decodable text, activities to go with each and every lesson. And it's pretty easy to read, it's very user-friendly, so this is a great place to start. For a longer, more in-depth option, I did the IMSI Orton-Gillingham training, IMSI standing for the Institute of Multisensory Education. They do a week-long intensive training where you are on the computer every single day, they do it virtually, which is great, and they send you all the materials and you really learn how to teach the Orton-Gillingham way and include multisensory education for your students. But it comes with 3 different manuals from kindergarten all the way to 2nd grade. It comes with a lot more instruction and a lot more background about why we teach this way too. So the UFLI manual is absolutely wonderful. I don't have bad things to say about it at all. If you want to start there, this is a much larger time investment and money investment, but it is so worth it if that's something you are interested in and gaining all that knowledge and learning how to best teach your struggling readers. This is a great option. And for a completely different option, this right here at reading.com is an app on the App Store that is absolutely amazing for teaching your students how to read. Now, I know you're probably thinking, oh wait, an app? Is this just like a review game for them? But no, this is actually meant to be a completely parent and child thing that they do together. In fact, it has like scripted lessons for the parents to actually help their students, and it walks them through each of the components of an effective phonics lesson. It also has little codes that parents have to put in so they can do a lesson each day for about 20 minutes. Let me show you what it looks like. All right, so here's one of the beginner lessons. Let me show you what it looks like. Like I said, this is meant to be done with a parent, so it'll always have you sign in first, 714. And it will take you through the different steps for teaching the lessons. Since this is still a beginner lesson and we're working on letter sounds, it'll always start with an alphabet song. Their song is really cute. It's not the typical alphabet song. So let's hear.
What you wanna bet? You can learn the alphabet. What you wanna bet? You can learn the alphabet. Repeat after me.
Let me tell you, it is very catchy. It gets stuck in my head all the time. And then you move on to the next part of the lesson. This is all meant to be done in one day. So we'll do a little letter review, which is great. This is the letters we've already learned. And it tells you right up here, this is what the parent is supposed to say. What letter is this? M. Say the sound slowly, then fast. And I love these sliders here. So this is what we're telling our students, and they will have already done this. So to say it slowly, they will say, and they will drag it slowly. And then when they say it fast, they say, and they'll get used to that. What letter is this? A. Say the sound slowly, then fast. Ah. Ah. Then of course we learn our new concept. So here we're gonna learn a new letter. So here it says, listen carefully to learn a new letter, and we are going to learn about the letter T. And it will be a little instructional video that teaches us not only what sound T makes, but also that T is usually a fast sound. It's not a continuous sound like M where we can say, and hold it. It's just T, and it will say that in the video. After the video, it gives you a chance to practice T. And then it says hint down here is that you want to make sure you're saying T, not ta, right? We're not adding that schwa after it. Then again, it gives you parent prompts to go ahead and use with your students. Woohoo! After we learn the new letter, there's a sound story where we are listening for the new sound we heard.
Tim and Travis tried to play tag.
Next, we go on to saying sounds. So first they've listened to the sounds and now they're going to say the sounds. And again, this is done with the parent. So I'm going to say a word slowly, then you say it slowly too. Ram. And now we say it fast, ram. So we're teaching students to kind of blend those sounds together, get ready for a new word, it. Now say it fast, it. In this lesson, students will actually start blending sounds together. So what's the first sound we're going to say? And students would say, s. What's the next sound? Ah. Let's blend it together. And it'll show you how we will blend it together.
Sa.
And then you'll practice it yourself. Sa. Sa. So you can see it's a great scope and sequence because we're only blending sounds students have already learned. So here we have at, at, with t being our new sound that we learned, and A being a review sound. At. We also have some letter formation practice to show big T and little T, and it has you actually practice making it yourself. It follows the steps, go down and then over, down and then across the line. So students love getting to practice this the correct way, and then they'll actually make some themselves. So then they'll write big T, little T, and practice. The last lesson is a little quick check where it just gives you some prompts to review the sound you learned today. Now, what I love about this is each lesson takes about 20 minutes a day, and it really makes you go through each lesson before you can progress to the next one. So a completely different option than the other two manual types, very parent friendly, which I love about it, and highly engaging for your students. Obviously that's great for some one-on-one practice as opposed to the other interventions which are meant for like small groups, could also be used one-on-one as well. If you're interested in trying out reading.com, they actually reached out to me and gave me a little offer code. So you can get 3 months for the price of just 1 month. So I will link that down in the description in case you want to check it out. Tip number four to help your struggling readers is to make sure you are incorporating multisensory learning. Now, the four main components of multisensory learning include visual, so learning through watching and seeing, auditory, learning through listening and hearing sounds, kinesthetic, learning through physical activity or body movement, as well as tactile, learning through the sense of touch. So when you're teaching phonics skills to your students, you want them to practice using some of those different multisensory techniques. And when you're doing this, you do want to make sure that it is actually multisensory, meaning you're using two senses at one time. Oftentimes we might ask students to, you know, make the letter A in some sand, right? But if they're only drawing it in the sand, they're actually only doing that tactile type of learning. They're not using the auditory or the visual. So we might need students to actually say, ah, as they make an A, ah. They should be doing both at the same time. You might have students do some skywriting as they say the steps to make the letter A, as some kinesthetic movement, as well as, again, saying the steps aloud. There are many different tools you can use to help make your instruction more multisensory. Of course, there are things like those poppers. I'm sure you've seen them everywhere. This way, students can actually sound out the sounds and count the sounds in a word while also, you know, pushing it in and having some sort of tactile movement. You can use sandpaper, you can use sand in trays. You can buy some really cheap shampoo or gel and put it in some sandwich baggies and close it up so they can kind of make their own little gel board as they write these letters. But you'll wanna make sure that in some way you are having students listen to the word, see the word, write the word, have some sort of movement, and really combine all of those modalities. And last but not least, tip number 5 to help your struggling readers is don't skip the read aloud. Now, this part might not come during that small group focused or one-on-one instruction where you are really focusing in on phonemic awareness and phonics instruction, and that's fine, but it's so important that I wanted to make sure I shared it with you that even if you're not doing a read aloud during that time, don't skip out on it entirely. Learning to read can be difficult, especially for those who are struggling to learn how to read. We already mentioned it's probably going to take them longer, at a higher intensity for a longer period of time, with more repetitions to catch up to their peers, but we don't want that to be discouraging for them. And along the way, we don't want them to view reading as this cumbersome and non-enjoyable thing. We want them to still enjoy reading. Plus, there are so many benefits of reading aloud. When we read stories to our students, it allows us to practice oral comprehension, which we know is an important part of teaching students how to read. They can still practice many comprehension skills even if they are not reading the text, right? Oral listening comprehension is great for them to practice. We can introduce our students to many new vocabulary words that they in turn can use in their own language. We can read books with all sorts of different themes about friendship and perseverance and honesty. And we can also just read to enjoy reading. We can get lost in the story and have a whole lot of fun. So if you are a parent watching this video and you are spending, you know, those 30 minutes a day with that direct focused instruction and you're catching your student up, awesome. Make sure at another point in time throughout the day that you're just reading a quick story aloud. Ask them some questions, enjoy the story, talk about new vocabulary and themes, whatever you'd like, just have fun with it. And if you're a teacher in the classroom, make sure you're asking yourself, are my struggling readers still getting that read aloud instruction, right? If they get pulled out for more intense literacy instruction, that's great, but are they missing the read aloud? Are they missing the vocabulary component and the comprehension component? That's something you may want to rework. All right, so there were my 5 tips to help you teach your struggling readers. Just to recap, tip number 1 is to make sure you know exactly what your student needs help with. And this is going to help by using a diagnostic screener and then following a scope and sequence. Tip number 2 is to remember that it might take longer than you think for your students to master some concepts. Tip number 3 is to follow research-based interventions. Tip number 4 is to incorporate multisensory learning. And tip number 5 is don't skip the read aloud. I would love to know your thoughts on these tips, or if you have any others that you would add in here, go ahead and let me know down in the comments below. As always, everything I mentioned in this video will be linked in the description, and if you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up so I know. Make sure you are subscribed to my channel and click that bell. That way you're notified of every new video. See you in the next one. Bye.